Next will be the strategic equity plan to the fall update. Dr. Swift.
Thank you, Madam President and trustees. I very much appreciate the planning committee reviewing our fall update on Monday evening. They'll be pulling up a presentation. We don't have to spend long on this, but we wanted everyone to know the work that is going on with our strategic equity plan. Trustees, you have linked into board docs all of the prior reports. We always have tried to report on this progress, both in the fall or late in the year, and then also in the spring. This past year, what I'm sharing with you today really contains no new information. We just wanted to update the progress that we've made with our current plan. You will recall, trustees, that we had planned originally that the latter half of this calendar year we would use to build out metrics and specific goals and metrics. And of course, we put that part of the community work on hold for just a bit, but we're bringing an update on what has been done. You have your sticker that Ms. Osinski put at your place, and you know, trustees, that for several years we've been really focusing on the Cobb and Crown Apple work, which is really about dignity and belonging. What we heard in 50, 60 in-person face-to-face meetings with stakeholders, and what we heard through several thousand pieces of feedback data, was this overwhelming theme around well-being. Well-being for our children, well-being for our adults. And so you can see our 23-24 focus is around all three of those components: dignity, belonging, and well-being. That is the foundation for our strategic equity plan. Go ahead. The dignity piece is that we know from research that without dignity as the foundation, any other equity strategy will fail. And so it is so important to have that in place first. Belonging, that idea of everyone feeling welcome in our schools. We know we have work to do in that area. And then, of course, this fundamental of well-being. The team has worked on, and our principals have been involved this fall as well on the next slide with just helping folks to understand some basic core values around dignity, belonging, and well-being. That belonging work is the Cornelius Minor work, We Got This, which is really about listening first to students, knowing our students by name, by strength, by culture, by story and need, listening to our students, to their experience, using what we hear to adjust our instruction. As we've shared this fall, we've really added well-being, understanding that it is the foundation for any meaningful learning, both the well-being of the children and the adults. And I love statement number four, that we know well-being includes individuals, families, environmental, social, political, and we would add now world influences, that really we are a micro of the macro. And we know that is not a surprise, but something that is important to remember as we plan our strategic equity plan. On the next slide, you'll see a very familiar framework. Trustees, we shared this out in March, April, May, June, and we asked everyone for feedback on the focus areas for the framework. This is not the in-depth equity plan. That will come. But this is the framework for the equity plan. And, of course, our critical mission is focus area number two, academic learning, growth and achievement. We heard loud and clear that theme of well-being throughout our most recent community tour. Safety and security. We didn't have a single meeting where that doesn't come up among our staff, among our students, and in our community. We know that if we're going to be an organization that's about equity, we will have to get at systems and procedures in the district, practices and policies, and equity-centered leadership at every level of the organization. And then key and critical is that student, family, and community partnership. In the yellow, trustees, you remember that we talked a lot about community engagement. The listen and learn was about hearing voices who may not normally be heard. As we said, the part on the bottom, our outcomes, our measures, that was originally scheduled for the latter half of this year. Now we'll place that on a pause as we have our framework, and we know that we will be building this out more in the future. This is the build out of academic learning, growth, and achievement. So for about 4 years now, 3 or 4 years, we've had the framework for equitable instruction. Trustees, you've seen this in many, many updates. We have changed the middle of the graphic to hold the dignity and belonging. But you know these four cornerstones: culturally affirming instruction, that students can see themselves in their curriculum materials, in their classroom learning; universally designed instruction, active and engaged instruction, and instruction with linguistic and academic accommodations. Trustees, you're aware that more than 2,000 of our students are English language learners now. 2,500 of our students are students who are served on an IEP, an individual education plan, plus our students on 504s, and we all know that there are many, many students who may not have their needs documented on a plan, but they certainly have needs that we need to address. So the framework for equitable instruction, trustees, at that link, you'll see version 3.0, so 3 years of working and improving this plan. We're moving this work along three areas. This has been true and a part of the plan from the beginning, is that idea of transforming culture. If our schools aren't places where everyone's in and nobody's out, then we're not going to be able to do the equity work. Secondly, that we're about shifting practice. Practice has to change in order for outcomes to change. So we're shifting practice at classroom, at school, and across the organization. And then finally, that we are redesigning the system. A traditional American education system is designed where it gets uneven outcomes. And so we have to be busy about this work to redesign the system. And our team is ready and already doing that work. Now, alongside the framework, the focus areas, the next slide really is about those habits of practice and discipline across the organization. You saw evidence of fiscal responsibility this evening. We are effective. We are transparent. We are equitable stewards of our resources. High-performing team, communication, our updated school buildings. We're about to move into the part of the meeting where we'll focus on that again. And then environmental sustainability. You can see those organizational disciplines and practices activated, realized in the following two slides. And we've linked in on each area the evidence that shows that this work is already in progress, and we need to add there on talented, diverse, high-performing team. But on all the other areas, you will see that we have the evidence of the plan and the program behind the organizational discipline and practice. So we want folks to know these are not new ideas. These are deeply embedded in the very DNA of our organization. The 8,000 series policies that the board passed a few years ago on environmental sustainability, the environmental sustainability framework that was approved by the board just a little over a year ago. These are all deeply embedded evidence of our organizational practices. On the next slide, really around all of this is our process and our belief and our very nature that community engagement will be woven throughout all of our work. So we have core values about authentic listening, open and honest dialogue, a process of doing with, whether trustees, we've been out at the bus stop, we've been in the housing, affordable housing community, community centers. We go to hear this feedback and input, and it has weighed heavily into the framework for our equity plan. So we'll just end by showing again that the next frontier would be to document outcomes and accountability measures. Certainly in our school improvement plans, every school has a documented school improvement plan. That work is already ongoing. So trustees, I want you to know we're not waiting to have metrics to show our work, but in terms of building out this public plan with the community, that would be a natural next step. In the meantime, on our next slide, our team, I'm really proud that everywhere I go in the district, our teachers, our teams, really, I see them living the culture of dignity, the environment of belonging. And we are working valiantly now to understand, explore, and begin to activate what a culture of well-being would look like. Trustees, you know and I know that educators have been wired for decades not to think about their own well-being. In fact, I'm looking at several ones in the room. They've been wired to carry on no matter what. And so this really is a shift in organizational understanding that we're going to work hard in the future to create, presently and moving forward, to create a culture and an organization where folks are well. If the children aren't well, if the adults aren't well, if the families aren't well, we cannot achieve our critical mission. I'm excited for the district to do this work. It's very exciting work to do together. And I'm glad that we are owning that is the next frontier of where we need to go. I've included some of the sources. Each year we have a book or two. This is not all of them, but it's kind of some of the high-level ones that we've used. And trustees, you've received these, and I'm proud that Ms. Parks took care of you, Trustee Feaster. So she delivered on that. Thank you. And so we know our next steps. In the meantime, our system is learning and working every day around the fundamentals of dignity, belonging, and well-being. So with that, trustees, I really very much appreciate the opportunity to bring the fall update. I know that folks will continue to do excellent work in all of these areas. Thank you, Madam President and trustees.